Hi, let's talk about Horner syndrome. In this video, we'll discuss Horner syndrome and how its symptoms help to illustrate the targets and functions of the sympathetic nervous system in the head. So Horner syndrome is the effect of an interruption of the sympathetic pathway. This may either be congenital, so at birth, or acquired. There are different types of syndromes depending on which part of the pathway is affected. So for instance, if it's a disruption within the central nervous system, it is a first order. If it's a disruption of the pathway of the preganglionic fibers, it's a second order. Or of the postganglionic fibers, it is a third order. Keep in mind that all of the preganglionic fibers that are going to serve any of the cervical sympathetic ganglia ascend from the thoracic spine. So that means that it's not just the cervical region that can produce Horner's, but it's also an interruption in the thoracic region which could produce Horner's. And it is that superior cervical ganglion which is providing the exclusive postganglionic fibers to the head, either via the internal or external carotid plexuses. So let's take a look at the symptomology. With Horner's, we have several potential symptoms. They all aren't necessarily present. It's going to depend on what order of Horner's, but Horner's is generally characterized as unilateral. That means on one side, meiosis. Meiosis is a constricted pupil. So if we look here, we can see that this pupil is smaller than that pupil. It's harder to tell on brown-eyed individuals. That pupil is smaller than that pupil. So this is the affected side. Within the eye, there are two sets of muscles that control the pupil. There are the dilator pupillae under sympathetic control, and then the sphincter pupillae under parasympathetic control. If the dilator pupillae muscle are denervated, then the sphincter pupillae muscle are unbalanced. Thus, that is why the constricted pupil or meiosis is present with Horner's on one side. The other symptoms include ptosis. Ptosis is a droopy eyelid. So controlling the superior eyelid or the superior palpebrae is a muscle called levator palpebrae superioris. And a tiny slip of that muscle is smooth muscle embedded within the tarsal plate there, which when sympathetically activated really opens the eyes wide. But there's generally some sympathetic tone to it. When that muscle is denervated, the eyelid droops. The next symptom is more of a consequence of the previous symptom, ptosis, and that's pseudo-enophthalmos, which means a pseudo-sunken globe. When the eyelids become droopy, it gives the eyes an appearance of being sunken. The next symptom is hyperemia. Hyperemia is a flushed appearance to the skin. This occurs because the vasomotor fibers are denervated. Without the tone on those coming from the fibers to the walls of the blood vessels, the walls of the blood vessels relax, and as a result, more blood flows through them. Near the surface of the skin, this gives a flushed appearance, hence hyperemia. Emia means blood, hyper more. So more blood leads to flushed skin. The next symptom is anhidrosis. Or lack of hydrosis, sweating. So this is a lack of sweating. Sweat glands are exclusively supplied by the sympathetic division of the autonomic nervous system. When the pseudomotor fibers that serve them are denervated, they cease to excrete. And as a consequence, there's unilateral anhidrosis. So, if you see any cluster of unilateral meiosis, ptosis, pseudoenophthalmos, hyperemia, or anhidrosis, you'll understand, given the sympathetic pathways to these various target tissues, why. So we've discussed the types of Horner syndrome, where the interruptions may occur, and how this might affect target tissues, and how this may present unilaterally as a cluster of symptoms. This is your summary slide. I thank you for your time.